Good morning, everyone. I was caught a wee bit in the hop there, but welcome to Inshes East. We're halfway through 2 weeks of school holidays here in Inverness, so some of you may be here today visiting on holiday, and some may be watching online who are away from us on holiday, but you're all very welcome indeed. There is holiday truth trackers this morning for those from nursery school age up to primary seven. And so any visiting children are welcome to join the truth trackers when they go out to their groups after the second singing. And if you haven't found it yet, there is a creche this morning for the threes and under, and that's along at the end of the corridor on this side of the church. David Scott, our minister, is one of those who is away on holiday, so we're grateful to, again, to Alex MacPherson, who's going to be leading and preaching this morning and next Sunday morning too. Now, this is one of those Sundays when there's lots that could be mentioned by way of notices, but it would take too long, so I would just refer you to the website and to the Wednesday email update, where you may have already seen that the funeral service for Ian MacDonald of Swanston Avenue and latterly the Bruach Care Home in Nairn will be on Thursday this week. Ian died this past Monday, and he will be best known probably to those of you who were in the East congregation, where he was an elder. His wife Jane died last year, and we'll be remembering their son Finlay and his wife Lisa especially as they prepare for the service, which will be at Chisholm's funeral home at 12:15 this Thursday afternoon, and Andrew McGowan will be leading the service. I will just mention that anyone who is able to go to the service at the Daviot Care Home at 3:00 this afternoon will be very much welcomed by the residents there and those who will be leading. And then please do come this afternoon, if you can, for a snack tea at 5:30 before our evening gathering at 6:30. Here in the church, when Bruce Ritchie will be leading and preaching on faith and doubt from the Gospel of Luke. And there's another big birthday today because Carol Fox turns 80, and she's just a wee bit behind her husband James, who had his 80th birthday just a few weeks ago. So happy birthday to you both from all of us. I know you'll be watching now, if not later. And I don't think I said it earlier, but there will be tea and coffee and other refreshments served as usual after our gathering this morning. So if you can stay for behind for a while afterwards, please do. Thanks.
Thank you, Norman, for the notices. Good morning, everyone. We're going to begin our service by singing to God's praise and glory in Bless the Lord, O my soul. Do you remember we used to sing Count Your Blessings, name them one by one? I'm showing my age, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Well, in this hymn, there's this lovely line, "For all your goodness, I will keep on singing 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul."
Thank you.
join our hearts together in prayer. Let us pray. Our great God, we lift up our hearts and voices to you this morning. We're so thankful to be here in the presence of the living God. And today we thank you for the gift of life, for the beauty and wonder of the world around us, and for the blessing of family and friends and this church. But more than anything else, we thank you for the precious gift of your Son, our Savior, the risen Lord Jesus. Lord, as we bow before you, I've been thinking about that passage in the Gospels where Peter makes his great confession. They've been fishing all night with nothing to show for all their efforts. And we remember how Jesus asked them to put the boat into deeper water. And we remember Peter's reluctance. We've worked hard all night and haven't caught anything, but because you say so, I will let down the nets. And then Peter's response, when the nets were filled with fish, Peter fell to his knees and said, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." And later he would discover the unstoppable power and pull of your redeeming love. Lord, we pray for such a response today, not just in our broken, troubled, dark world, but also in our hearts, that we would have Peter's understanding of how deep and dark our sin is, but that we too would know and feel the height and depth and breadth of your redeeming love. So would you take from our lives the selfishness and stubbornness that can be so deep-rooted, and every proud thought and every hidden grudge. And as we wait upon you, please stir up our hearts in worship. Now we pray for wisdom and courage to proclaim your life-changing gospel. And as a church, as we worship, fill our hearts with songs of praise and psalms of faith which tell of your greatness. And may your great love and power be at work in our world and in this place. And we ask all this in your precious name as we say together the prayer you taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Our reading for this morning is Matthew chapter 27 and verse 62, and I'm going to ask Marilyn if she would come and share that reading. Matthew chapter 27.
So we're continuing the story after Jesus had been crucified and buried in a new tomb cut out of the rock with a large stone sealing the entrance. Verse 62. The next day, the one after preparation day, the chief priests and the Pharisees went to Pilate. "Sir," they said, "we remember that while he was still alive, that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise again.' So, give order for the tomb to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal the body and tell the people that he's been raised from the dead. This last deception will be worse than the first." "Take a guard," Pilate answered. "Go, make the tomb as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. And the guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus, who is crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy, and they ran to tell his disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee. There they will see me." Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your word and your resurrection. Amen.
Thank you. Now, my birthday is not until January, which is a long way away, but I'm seeing the birthday box here, and it's been really tempting for me because I like chocolate, but I promise I haven't been in this box. But if you have a birthday this month, come and get your treat. Nobody? Any adults? Don't be shy now. Would you like to come forward? Ah!
Granddad.
Right, and you've got the right colours on this morning, haven't you? Yeah. For your granddad. You're very welcome. Anyone else? No, okay, good. Now you just keep your eye on this box, make sure I don't sneak my hand into it during the service. So, you keep an eye on me. I need watching, I tell you. Last week, we had some of the family up, and it was Easter weekend, and we were sitting around the breakfast table, Ruth and myself, and Andrew, who is our oldest son, and our grandson, Alexander. And we're sitting around enjoying our breakfast. And Andrew, he was being a little bit rude, and he was on his phone. You would never do that, but at the breakfast table, he's on his phone, and he's checking out various things. And suddenly he looks up, and there's this big smile on his face. And he said, "Have you heard this story?" And then he went on to tell us the story that he'd discovered on Google. And I'll just tell you the story that Andrew told us last weekend. He said, "There's this little island off Orkney." Has anyone ever been to Orkney before? Yes. Has anyone ever been to this little island called Sandy? I knew you would have been, Trevor. I knew, John. Yeah, okay, a few of you. So Andrew said, "There's this little island called Sandy, and there's less than 500 people on this island. And there's only one shop, one store, and the shopkeeper's name is Dan. and we'll just see what Dan looks like. So that's Dan. Now, maybe that's let the cat out the bag and you'll know the rest of the story, but we didn't really know this story. And Andrew says, there's this guy called Dan. He's a shopkeeper, and every Easter, he orders all the Easter eggs. Now, being a small island, he only orders 80 Easter eggs, which is plenty. But somehow he made a bit of a blunder and maybe pressed the wrong button. I don't know. Maybe he wasn't all that good with technology. But he managed to order 800 eggs, 80 cartons instead of 80 individual Easter eggs. And what got out over the community, but not just in Orkney, but further afield in Scotland and other countries too, about Dan's blunder. And Dan wondered how he could turn this to something good. And so he decided that he would sell some of the eggs to a charity. And the local charity is the RNLI. Now, if you live on an island, there's no better charity than the lifeboats, because they're there all the time. And so word got round that Dan was selling these extra eggs for this charity, and people started buying them, not just in Orkney, but further afield, and they were sending money in to Dan for the charity. And even some of the companies that make the chocolate eggs heard about it, and they were sending money in too. And the last time I checked, Dan had raised almost £20,000 from these extra Easter eggs for the Royal National Lifeboat Institution. Isn't that a great story? And we kind of all smiled round the table that something that looked like an absolute disaster had been turned into the most wonderful blessing. And as Andrew's telling this story, light bulb moment for me, and I thought, you see, when you're a preacher, you always try and line things up. And I thought, that's like a mini parable of the gospel. It really is. Something that looked like just a great disaster has been turned into the greatest blessing. And that is the Easter story, the cross. It looked like just the greatest disaster ever. Jesus crucified on the cross, the darkest day, the loneliest day. But God turns that terrible minus into a wonderful plus. And 3 days later, Jesus rises from the dead and walks out of that tomb and is alive forevermore. And that is the good news of the gospel, that yes, the cross looks like the greatest tragedy, the greatest disaster, the darkest day ever. But God comes on the scene and raises Jesus to new life, and he's alive forevermore. And we just have a great God who can turn some things in our life that aren't good, they seem like disasters, and God can turn those things to the greatest good. He can turn your minuses into pluses. So we're going to celebrate our great God, and we're going to put this next hymn up. And it's a video, in fact, and hopefully the actions will be in the video and I'll not be left high and dry up here. Our God is a great big God.
Our God is a great big God.
God is a great big God. So you can all go through now to your different classes. And as you're going, I'm going to ask Pete if he would come forward and lead us in our prayers of intercession.
Good morning. It's lovely to have folk visiting with us today, and it's a privilege to lead you all in prayer, both here in the building at Inshes East, and also those of you who are joining us online, either just now or perhaps a little later, from wherever you may be around the world at this special time of year. We are so grateful to God for his provision of technology that enables us to come together, and his ever-open door to where we bring our prayers of intercession now. Let's pray. Our faithful and loving Heavenly Father, our constant and brightly shining light in a turbulent world, we take time out from the different challenges and situations on the front lines of our daily lives to join in prayer before you now. And we do this knowing that there is always room in your house for our prayers. We have just sung, you are a great big God that knows us and loves us. And especially at this Easter time, we marvel on the supreme sacrifice you made for us in your beloved Son Jesus at the cross, in the midst of the sin and rejection that we showed to you. We give thanks for the ongoing hope that you show us in his resurrection, and the continuation of his work through your Holy Spirit. And we rest assured that in all situations, you work for the good of those who love you. We reside in a world that has strayed far from your word and your example, and yet you have not strayed from us, and you remain in changing times the same today as you were yesterday and will be tomorrow. We thank you that we can meet freely and join together to come before you. We do know, however, that there are many places where this is not at present possible, and we pray for all our Christian brothers and sisters, wherever they may be, that they would one day know this freedom, and that in the intervening period, they would know you walk closely with them. And in this regard, we pray for the ongoing work of the Open Doors Ministry. We continue to pray too for all who are affected by war and conflict, something you never wanted in the world, you so lovingly created. We pray for peace and an end to hostilities in the countries of the Middle East, in Ukraine and in Sudan. We remember today and bring before you the family and friends of all who have been bereaved in all nations. We pray for those who bring aid and medical supplies, for their bravery in the midst of the fighting. And we remember especially the 7 aid workers who lost their lives doing just this a few days ago. We pray for the safe release of those still held hostage. And we pray for world leaders and all those in authority with influence to make wise decisions that lead to a lasting peace in all conflicts. We too today remember the country of Taiwan following this devastating earthquake, and we pray for those who have been bereaved and all those who are involved in the challenging rescue operations, especially in the remote mountain regions. We do thank you, Lord, for all the connections around the world you bless and enrich us with here at Inshes East, and the valuable part each and every person on your mission field plays. And today we especially give thanks for the Christian Engineers in Development and Jonathan and Trevor's successful trip in the ongoing work at Kuleva Hospital in Uganda. in our country, we bring before you the royal family, and we thank you for their service. And especially just now, we would pray that King Charles and Catherine, the Princess of Wales, would know your sustaining and healing hand, and that their young family members would know your peace and reassurance. We pray too for all our elected officials in the varying challenges they face daily in leadership. We pray that they would be able to work well together, using wisely the gifts and knowledge you have given them in the way you set the example of how you intended them to be used. We continue to bring before you the Martin family in the upbuilding of your church in West Smethwick, and pray for workers to join with them as they spread your light round their parish. At this holiday time, we give thanks for SU, and we pray for the camps taking place and for the understanding and application of your word amongst the young folk as it is shared with them. In our own parish here at Inches East, we give thanks for how 21 years ago this month, you called us from the West Parish to serve you here, and how you have blessed and directed us so generously and lovingly along the way, and brought us together with our brothers and sisters from the East a year ago to share in that service and the spreading of your good news in our community and beyond. We do pray for all in the community of Milton of Leys today, and we thank you for bringing Chris and Lindsay and the family to continue the upbuilding of your work there. And we ask on your blessing as they take a little break just now to be with family. We know, Father, we do nothing in our own strength, but only in yours. And we thank you that your mercies are new every morning. And we pray especially today for all within our own church family who are experiencing challenging times, be it with health issues, loneliness, caring responsibilities, financial burdens, or the pain of bereavement. Would they know that you are walking with them and that you understand? We would especially ask that today for the family of the late Ian MacDonald, giving thanks for his dedicated service to you over many years, especially as an elder in the East Church. May his son Finlay, wife Lisa, and the family know your peace in these early days of loss and in the months ahead. We also continue to bring before you Lord Ian and Dorothy and the family in the loss of dear Carolyn, and we pray too that they would know your sustaining love and guiding hand. We thank you that you walk with us through all the different situations that we face. And we pause for just a short period of silence to bring before you our own personal prayers, perhaps not known to anyone else, Lord, though known by you. We do give thanks, Lord, for the faithful preaching of your word in this place. And we remember David and Susan and Cleopas and Atalyn as they take a break at this time. And we pray this would be a blessed time of rest and relaxation for both couples and their families. We thank you for calling Alec James to share your word with us today. And we pray that you would open our hearts and minds to receive that word, and that we would know how individually you would like us to apply it in our own daily lives. And in your precious Son Jesus' name, we bring all these prayers before you, Lord. Amen.
Back in 2018, the Gettys started a project to put music to all the Psalms. They really wanted to encourage congregations to sing more psalms. And the very first one that they put music to was Psalm 130. And I did run this past David because we haven't sung it since we've been here. But he said that you did sing it during lockdown. So, of course, you'll remember this quite well. And it's Psalm 130. And I thought I would just read a few words of this psalm. It's one of our favourite psalms, and it was a favourite psalm of Charles Wesley and John Calvin and Martin Luther, Psalm 130. Out of the depths to thee, O Lord, I cry. Hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to my cry for mercy. If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, and therefore you are feared. And especially this line, I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I put my hope. I wait for the Lord, and in his word I put my hope. I will wait for you. So I hope we can do this justice, since it's been a wee while since it's been sung. Lord, from the depths I call to you.
That's not quite right. There's a change between verses 1 and 2. So we'll go back to verse 2. Is that okay?
Thank you.
keeping us right with that. It was definitely worth going back. So now we know next time we sing it. Thank you. I just want to lead us in prayer before we turn to God's word. Father, we thank you for lovely songs of praise and hymns of faith that lead us and help us to be in that place where our minds and hearts are open to your word and to your Holy Spirit working in our lives. Father God, as we come to some great passages in Scripture, we pray that they would indeed be food for our souls and that we would be challenged, but also that we would rejoice in what you have done for us and what you are doing for us. So we look to you, we trust in you, we lean in you alone, and thank you for all your mercies. In Jesus' name, amen. If you have your Bibles with you, I will tell you where to turn to just in a moment, and we're going to end up in Matthew 28, but not for a little while. On this first Sunday after Easter, I want to stay with this great theme of the resurrection, because in a sense, every Sunday is the day when we should celebrate that Christ is risen, because of course that's why it was changed back in the day from the Saturday to the Sunday, because this was such a momentous event that it should be celebrated all the time by God's people. The title for this morning's sermon is The Unstoppable Power of God. Now, I know I've mentioned before that our youngest son, John, lives in London, and although he's 30, we still like to keep an eye on him just to make sure that he's behaving himself. If you're a parent, then you'll know what it's like. It doesn't matter how old your children are. So every trip down to London for Ruth and I is an opportunity to see John. But as I've mentioned before, it's also an opportunity to worship in different churches in London. So over the years, we've been to Westminster Chapel and All Souls Langham Place, Holy Trinity Brompton, and St. Helen's Bishopgate. Well, the last time we were in London, we went to Westminster Central Hall. For 16 years, from 1939 to 1955, W.E. Sangster was the minister of that great congregation. And his sermons, Sunday by Sunday, were used to awaken not just his own congregation, but also his own denomination, the Methodist Church. And W.E. Sangster preached every Sunday to 3,000 people. I mean, my knee's not preaching to 300 people. What must it have been like for W.E. Sangster preaching to 3,000 people every Sunday? And he had this great passion for the lost. And he had a vision to see every denomination full of dynamic churches. And what I love about him is that he never ever criticized a fellow pastor, and he never ever criticized another denomination. Indeed, on one occasion, he was with a group of 2,000 ministers who had gathered for a congregation. That would be my worst nightmare, I think, being in a room with 2,000 ministers. And I just know there'd be a lot of big egos there. And he was asked to pray. And I love what he said in his prayer. He said, "Lord, we don't mind who is second as long as you are first." And that's just such a great thing to say. And it just so happens that one of my favorite W.E. Sangster stories is about this Easter time. As I said, he was this powerful and passionate preacher. But in the mid-1950s, he began to lose his voice and he began to lose his mobility because of a progressive muscular disease, which we now know was MND. And W.E. Sangster realized that the end was near, and so he had to give up preaching, but he fully committed himself to prayer and to a writing ministry. And eventually Sangster's voice completely failed, and he couldn't stand on his feet. And this is what I find so moving. On Easter Sunday 1959, just a few weeks before his death, with a shaky hand, he wrote to his daughter Margaret, and this is what he said. "It is a terrible thing to wake up on Easter Sunday and have no voice to shout, 'He is risen.' But it would be still more terrible to have a voice and not want to shout, 'He is risen.'" And of course, he's right. And I just thought this would be a wonderful opportunity for Inches East, we who have voices, to shout out those three words: "He is risen." Is that about the best you can do? Wow. "He is risen. Hallelujah, Christ is risen." What a great theme this is. The whole season of Easter is quite simply the greatest victory ever over the darkest enemy ever. And if anything in this tired, broken, dark world is worthy of celebration, it's this: that Christ is risen. Now, there's a word that I'm going to be using quite a lot this morning, and it's a word that you'll not find in the Bible, but it's a great word. It's a real word of encouragement, and I love this word, and the word is unstoppable. Something's going to happen. Something's coming. Something's just around the corner, and it's unstoppable. A bit like an earthquake or a stampede or a tsunami. And unstoppable is a word that comes to mind when you think about the resurrection of Jesus. When you look at the empty tomb, you see evidence of the unstoppable power of God. And it's power for all our struggles, power for all our disappointments, power over all our sin. It's the unstoppable power of God. Now listen to how Paul puts it. You know this verse, Ephesians 1:19. Don't turn there yet. I'm going to give you your instructions in a moment. Ephesians 1:19. Paul says, "How unbelievably great is his power to help those who believe in him. The same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead." So that's what we're talking about now, not just any old power, but the same mighty power that raised Christ from the dead. So as we trace this theme, what I want to do this morning, and I promise I'll let you go before 12 o'clock, I want to start with David in the Old Testament, and I'm going to link him into Jesus in the New Testament. I'm going to kind of bring those two lives together. So here's your starting place. Can you turn to 1 Samuel 22? And that would be really helpful. And you'll get the most out of this if you keep one eye on the preacher and the other eye on your Bible. That would be really great. So 1 Samuel 22, and then we'll finish in Matthew 28. But don't put your finger in Matthew 28, because it'll be a wee while before we get there. For a moment, we're going to walk through some of the highs and lows in David's life. And we're going to see this morning how David found strength and power in God. So 1 Samuel 22. And as you find that passage, what I want to do is kind of set the scene. And I'm going to ask you to do something that I've asked Ruth to do for me on many occasions. and she's not here, she threw the kids, and that is to wait for me. So will you do that? Psalm 130, we sung those words, I will wait for you. Well, please wait for me in 1 Samuel 22, and I'll meet you there shortly. So, David, the big turning point in David's life, as I'm sure you know, was that day when the prophet Samuel turned up in Bethlehem. And God had rejected Israel's king, Saul. And the Holy Spirit leads this old prophet Samuel to David. And the Holy Spirit kind of whispers in Samuel's ear, rise and anoint him, for he is the one. And we read from that day on, the power of the Lord falls upon David's life. And there's our word, our theme, the unstoppable power of God. And David found favor with God, and great things are going to happen in this young man's life. And for a while they did. King Saul just loves David. He's his favorite musician. David ends up becoming best friends with the king's son, Jonathan, and he marries the king's daughter, which, by the way, was always a good career move back in those days. And it just seemed as if everything David touched turned to gold. And then a funny thing happened to him on his way to the top. It all kind of fell apart, and all those wonderful things that he achieved were just stripped away from him one by one. He'd become so successful that King Saul got jealous of him. And things got so bad that the king took his spear and hurled it at David to kill him. And David loses his job, he loses his income, he loses his security. And David ends up losing his family, his marriage, his home. And he tries to find Samuel, and you can just picture in your mind David looking for Samuel. But Saul hears about it and sends soldiers, and David has to escape. And soon after that, he hears that Samuel has died, and he will never see him again. He'll never get the advice of his, if you want, spiritual mentor again, because he's gone to glory. And David turns to his best friend, Jonathan, the king's son. And Jonathan loves David with all his heart, but he cannot lift a sword against his own father. And once again, David has to escape from the king's soldiers, and he'll never see his best friend again. So I would just say at this point, don't underestimate how deep and dark the valley is that David finds himself in. And you know that little phrase, just when you think it can't get any worse? It does. And that's true for David. It becomes too dangerous for him to live in Israel, and he has to leave the country that he loves. And he's been stripped of everything. And he runs for refuge to a city called Gath. And if you know your Bibles, as I know you do, then that will ring a wee bell, because Gath is the place where Goliath was from. And of course, David had slain the giant, and that's where David heads for. Now, if you're still waiting for me, Ruth would not be waiting for me by this stage, but if you're still waiting for me, well done, and this is where we meet up. 1 Samuel 22. So David has run to Gath for refuge, and it is the stronghold of his enemies, the Philistines. It's the one place on earth where Saul won't come looking for him. And here's the thing, David ends up living in a cave. Let's just read this together. 1 Samuel 22, verse 1. David left Gath and escaped to the cave of Adullam. When his brothers and his father's household heard about it, they went down to him there. This is David, who had once been in a palace, surrounded with wealth and power and security, and now it's all gone, and he's running for his life. He's living in a cave. So let's just pause for a moment and talk about the cave. It's where you end up when everything has been stripped away from you. It's a place where your dreams die. Maybe a friendship or a marriage or a death or a bad decision. And you find yourself asking, how did I ever end up in this place? And the hardest thing is that you begin to wonder if God has forgotten about you. Well, there's one big thing that I've been keeping from you. There's one big thing that you need to know. And I believe this to be deeply true in my life. The cave is where God does some of his best work in molding and shaping lives. It's probably not what you want to hear this morning, but believe me, it's true. And when people look back on their lives, when you ask someone, especially a Christian, about turning points in their life, things that brought them closer to God, well, you can be sure that 9 times out of 10, it's some trial, it's some sorrow, it's some deep grief. And this is right in line with what the writers of Scripture say. James puts it like this. You almost wish this verse wasn't in the Bible, but it is. When all kinds of trials and temptations crowd into your life, don't resent them as intruders, but welcome them as friends. When's the last time I did that or you did that? When all kinds of trials and temptations crowd into your life, don't resent them as intruders, but welcome them as friends, because God's working in your life. Do you know that David spent 10 years in the wilderness? He was not entirely alone. Some people joined them. And this is what the Bible says about them, if you're still with me. 1 Samuel 22, verse 2. All those who were in distress or in debt or discontented gathered around him, and he, that is David, became their leader. About 400 men were with him. Doesn't really sound like a group of people who are full of promise and potential. Not the kind of guys you would call to make up your Kirk session today. The message calls them losers and vagrants and misfits of all sorts. Do you know anyone like that? Well, they form a community in a village called Ziklag, and they marry and they have families. And this is where the word of God just is so contemporary. Then one day the men go off to battle and they return to their village and homes. And they find that it's empty. Their families are gone. Follow with me, 1 Samuel 30, a few pages on. 1 Samuel 30, verse 3. And when David and his men came to Ziklag, they found it destroyed by fire, and their wives and sons and daughters taken captive. Verse 4. So David and his men wept aloud until they had no strength left to weep. So they've absolutely hit rock bottom. They are so overwhelmed, they are so crushed that they cried until they had no strength left to cry. I don't know if that's ever happened to you, but that's where David is. That's how low David is. He's lost so much. And things are so bad that even his own men around him, his band of brothers, want to kill him. Verse 6, David was greatly distressed because the men were talking of stoning him. Each one was bitter in spirit because of his sons and daughters. And now what comes is, I think, one of the most, in the context of what I've said, one of the most amazing verses, certainly in the Old Testament. You need to underline this, mark this. The end of verse 6. But David found strength in the Lord his God. Isn't that a great little verse? Isn't that just like a shaft of light right through all the darkness that David has been going through? Now, I don't know your circumstances, but I'm sure that little verse is meant for someone here this morning, or maybe someone who's listening in. When you think of how low and down and out David was, and then these remarkable words, but David found strength in the Lord his God. He begins to feel what we're talking about, the unstoppable power of God. And David returns to Israel and takes his rightful place as king. And I just wonder how often he would look back to those dark days, those dark times, to that cave where he had felt so alone, and yet he began to feel the unstoppable power of God. And it turns out that God was with him all the time. And it turns out that God understands about caves. And so does Jesus. Do you know how the New Testament opens? Matthew chapter 1 and verse 1. A record of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the Son of David. So you see those two lives just being brought together. And for a little while, just like David, everything was great. For a little while, it seemed that everything that Jesus touched turned to gold. Water into wine. The blind could see. The lame could walk. The lost were found. And people came to Jesus from all over, especially those who were discouraged, down and out, and in distress. And they would come, and he would heal them and love them and embrace them. And word began to spread, and the crowds grew, until one day Jesus came to Jerusalem, Palm Sunday, and the crowds lined the streets. And do you remember what they shouted on that day? Hosanna to the Son of David. But just like King David before him, Jesus lost everything, his position, his safety, his disciples, his friends. And he too had people who wanted to kill him. And this time they did. And they nailed him to the cross, the most perfect man who ever lived, the only one without sin. And he died on the cross, and they thought it was all over. And they took his body down from the cross. We've waited a while to turn to Matthew 28, but if you would turn there with me, and we'll pick up this last part of the story. And guess where they put the body of Jesus? Right at the end of Matthew 27. This is Pilate speaking. "Take a guard," Pilate said. "Go make the tomb, the cave, as secure as you know how." So they went and made the tomb secure by putting a seal on the stone and posting the guard. And they just forgot. Pilate, the soldiers, the religious leaders, all those who were opposed to Jesus, they just forgot that God does his best work in caves. And this is the good news part of the story right here. The cave is where we see the unstoppable resurrection power of God. And it just flows through this chapter, Matthew 28, 2. There's this violent earthquake. An angel of the Lord comes down from heaven and rolls away the stone. Verse 4, the guards were so afraid that they shook, they trembled, they were like dead men. Verse 5, the angel says to the woman, "I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here." Why? Because he's risen. Verse 8, so the woman hurried away from the tomb, afraid and yet filled with joy. And now this is our day, this good news about the unstoppable resurrection power of God. And we all have a choice. whatever dark place it is, to stay in that cave, that place, and complain about how unfair life is, and allow our spirit to wither, or choose a better way. The Bible invites us to put our hope and trust and faith in the Son of David, the risen Lord Jesus, the only one who can wipe our slate clean and forgive us for all our sins. Just a few days ago in my preparation, I was listening to an evangelist, a German, and he said this, and it made me sit up. He said, I don't ask people to come to Jesus. Now, you don't often hear an evangelist saying that. I don't ask people to come to Jesus. I ask them, why wouldn't you come? And I just thought that was great. Why wouldn't you come to the most amazing person who ever lived? Why wouldn't you come? Do you know, he never traveled more than 200 miles from his place of birth in Bethlehem. And yet, throughout history, he's changed lives all over the world. He lived in a day when religious people emphasized rules and regulations as the only way to God. And then Jesus stepped on the scene and he said, I am the way. No one comes to the Father except through me. And perhaps you know these famous words. 20 centuries, 21 now, have come and gone. And today he remains the central figure of the human race and the leader of all mankind's progress. All the armies that ever marched, all the navies that ever sailed, all the parliaments that ever sat, all the kings that ever reigned, put together, have not touched the lives of men and women on this planet as much as that one solitary life. So why wouldn't you come? Put your hope and trust in him, and then, like W.E. Sangster of Westminster Central Hall, you can shout from the very depth of your heart, he is risen. And you can know in your lives the unstoppable power of our great God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your word is all linked together. There's nothing that's off the margin. There's nothing that's isolated. And we thank you that the Bible is about Jesus, either looking towards him or his life itself or his coming again. Lord, we bless you and thank you that Jesus is that central figure. We want him to be first in our lives. And like W.E. Sangster, we don't care much who's second about denominations and churches, but we want Jesus to be first in this world and first in our life. So we give you all the praise and glory. And we ask ourselves that question that evangelist asked, why wouldn't we come? Why wouldn't we come to Jesus, the risen King, our Savior and Lord? Hear our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen. I almost feel I've picked all my favorite hymns this morning, which is maybe the one benefit of being up here for me. But I love this hymn. I've listened to it so much this past week online. Christ, our hope in life and death. Thank you. Now we say the grace to one another, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all.